You're listening to the audio production of He Chose the Nails, Audio Bible Studies, by Max Lucado, published by Zondervan and presented by the author. These audio Bible studies are a unique learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, He Chose the Nails includes high-quality live recordings that cover the important points from each chapter as well as relevant material from other sources.
When we think about the Lenten season leading up to Easter, the first thing that usually comes to mind is giving up. Jesus gave up his holy place in heaven to come down and live among us in our not-so-holy world. And every year during this time, we're called to give up something we cherish as a symbolic remembrance of what he gave up for us. That's a good and worthy practice. But perhaps we should reframe our thinking about the Lenten season. Maybe we should think of Lent as more of an extension of Christmas, a bookend, really. And instead of being a season of giving up, we should think of it as a season of gifts. In fact, I'm going to suggest that the gifts of Easter we're going to discuss are the most precious gifts any person could ever receive, because they cost God so much to give. There was a time many years ago when everything was handmade. The table that held our midday meal, the baskets that carried our goods, the hammers, the nails, the saws that built our houses, and the clothes that protected us from the elements. All were made by hand. Men and women worked for years at their craft, perfecting their techniques and skills and artistry until they were called master craftsmen or artisans. Today, most of the things we take for granted are mass-produced by machines, churning out thousands of identical pairs of jeans, coffee mugs, and automobiles. But in small pockets of artistic resistance all over the world, the traditions of craftsmen and artisans still flourish in the shops of weavers and blacksmiths and carpenters, metalworkers, and potters. Today, their work is mostly sold as gifts in small boutique stores. But what beautiful and significant gifts they are, made out of love and passion for the art of crafting by hand, made at a cost to the artist of time and effort, pain and persistence, and loved by the one who receives the gift as something unique and valuable, precious. Because when you get one of these handmade objects as a gift, you not only receive the physical piece of work, but also you get a piece of the heart and soul of the artist who gave so much of themselves to create it. One of the oldest and most practical craftsman skills is the art of basket weaving. In ancient days, in terms of usefulness to society, basket weaving was on the same essentials level as fire building and wheel making. Baskets were used as containers in every home. But they were also the original FedEx package for items carried by early traders from city to city. Plant materials ideal for the task included narrow leaves and fronds and vines. Most important, they needed to be pliable and strong. But there was often a catch. Some of the best materials, such as blackberry vines, had thorns. And the basket weavers often paid the price of scratched and cut hands as they worked to remove the thorns so they could weave the vines into something useful and beautiful. This brings us to our first gift that God gave us at the cross. Over 2,000 years ago, in a grimy stone cell in Jerusalem, a Roman soldier took some branches and wove what he assumed would be a gift of shame and mockery, a crown of thorns. Little did he know he was actually creating one of the greatest gifts of all, custom made just for us. Have you ever wondered why God gives so much? We could exist on less. He could have left the world flat and gray. We wouldn't have known the difference. But instead, he splashed orange in the sunrise and blue in the sky. He made the birds sing. He gave the flowers their fragrance. He gave food its taste. God's gifts shed light on his good and generous heart. But his greatest gift of all, his greatest act of love for us, was in sending Jesus into our world. Just think for a moment how amazing this gift was and what God had to give up to make it happen. In that instant, when Jesus was born, God swapped eternity for calendars. We may search out the moment the first wave slapped on a shore or the first star burst in the sky, but we'll never find the first moment when God was God. The Bible tells us that God is beyond our understanding. The number of his years is past finding out. There was no moment when God was not God, for he is eternal. But when Jesus came, this all changed. For the first time, he heard a phrase never used in heaven: "Your time is up." As a child, he had to leave the temple because his time was up. As a man, he had to leave Nazareth because his time was up. As the Savior, he had to die because his time was up. For 33 years, the stallion of heaven lived in the corral of time. And what about the fact that Jesus lived in a body? One moment he was a boundless spirit, equally present in Peking and Peoria, as active in Texas as Timbuktu. The next moment, he was flesh and bones, imprisoned in a human body, restricted by weary, prone muscles and eyelids. His once limitless reach was limited to the stretch of an arm. His speed checked to the pace of human feet. I wonder if he was ever tempted to reclaim his boundlessness in the middle of a long trip. Did he ever consider transporting himself to the next village? When rain chilled his bones, was he tempted to change the weather? When the heat parched his lips, did he give thought to popping over to the Caribbean for some refreshment? If he ever entertained such thoughts, he never gave in to them. Not once did Christ use his supernatural powers for personal comfort. Remarkable. But was Jesus' humanity the most remarkable part of God's gift in sending him into this world? Many would argue not. Many would point beyond the surrender of timelessness and boundlessness to the surrender of sinlessness. In the Bible, an object that symbolizes the consequences of sin in humanity's heart is a thorn bush. Back in Eden, when the shadow fell across the garden, the Lord said, "I will put a curse on the ground."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.